This is an NAC podcast.
Hello, and welcome to the Hexagon Studio. This is Marjolaine Fournier. I'm sitting here with Jean-Jacques Van Vlasler, and our topic is beautiful and immense and tragic and inspiring. It's Claude Vivier. He's a composer from Quebec, born in 1948. And our pretext is that we will be playing one of his pieces on tour called Lonely Child, on tour spring 2019 with Alexander Shelley, and Aaron Wall will be singing. Now, that's the setting. When you open the box to Claude Vivier, you discover a thousand things. I found myself, what was very annoying about this subject was that I couldn't read so much about it. Normally, when I sit down with you, Jean-Jacques, I bring with me all my notes, but also my bag with the books that I've read, the most important ones, four or five books at least. Here, I found two books, two tiny books. And the other reference was the recordings and the score. It amazes me that such a great man, a great composer, somebody that wrote masterpieces, short, beautiful, perfect pieces to me, has not been written about that much.
And that a great biography has been written by a professor at the University of Rochester. Yeah. And it's a very nice, rather objective book, and with good descriptions. It follows his life and puts the works within his life. And it comes from the outside. Why is it that his music is played in Europe, all over the place, that the Festival of Salzburg has 4 or 5 years ago created one concert only with Vivier's music within the great Festival of Salzburg, where usually you only get the great masterworks? Well, there were great masterworks in that church that day because it was a full Vivier program, which they never do. They do that for Mozart. Not for other composers. So that was when the Festival of Holland puts together his Copernicus opera, and which is, you know, a kind of reflection on death. And so it's at the outside that he's very well known, and in France, in Germany, in Holland, and in Austria. a very, very, very interesting and into the country kind of approaches. One of the books by my friend Robert Richard is a wonderful reflection on the thought process behind it, and philosophical book, and it's a kind of an enlightenment on many of the aspects of Claude Vivier. But the great book has never been written, and the great book is so difficult to write because the personality of Claude Vivier is of an extraordinary profoundness, and it is a moving character on a certain number of things, which are in my opinion what Schumann called lied in French, la douleur. You see, there's a way of having an illness inside which you don't know where it comes from. It is not something like, you know, you have a tooth pulled and you know where it comes from. You know, for a couple of days, you will have still, you know, some pain. It has nothing to do with pain. It is something internal of which you don't know the origin. Now, the origin is there, of course. And his origin is non-existence. How do you prove your existence? How do you become an existent? And that is where everything starts with him. And what he tried throughout his life is to become what you are. Now, I'm quoting Nietzsche here. To become what you are. This is the ultimate goal of human beings. And he had to do that from emptiness on. Mm-hmm. Emptiness, no father, no mother. Being adopted at 3. Being half-heartedly adopted. Up to a certain point, with difficulties and non-difficulties. And then he's being sent to the noviciat, which is, you know, the les frères maristes, the brothers, which is not really, it is religious, but they're brothers. They're not necessarily priests. So, you know, you can, when you get out of that school, you can become a music teacher, for example. But it's very religious also at the same time. And it's that world, in a world where the existence is at the outside of the grouping. So you have, he starts from that. His world is a world of how do I become me?
How do I become me? And at the same time, his start in life is so full of rejection and not listening to him and denying him and erasing him that he's starting from way back. He's not just a regular guy trying to become himself and taking his place in life. It's really, he's really the underdog, is what I'm saying. And you know,
he perceives himself very much as the underdog also. Well, why? Because he has no references. What are the references? The references are an interior world, an incredible rich interior world. And you know what, and it's carried by music. And now, what is music? Music, all music is a pursuit within oneself of a lost voice. Yeah. Now, this comes not from me, this comes from the philosopher Schlegel. Now, Schlegel is great romanticism. Yeah. A great romantic period of romanticism. It is not the romanticism of loving little flowers or having a bad love affair. It is asking yourself, what the hell are we doing here? what the hell is there a meaning behind all that? And behind all that, there is only one big shadow, and that big shadow is death. And with Claude Vivier, the search for this childhood unknown goes together with this dark background that hovers over all his music. And the tie between childhood, the tie between childhood, the tie between innocence that goes together with childhood, and the opening, that continuous opening into the depths of the question of behind all that, what is there, is the music of, is his response. And he started to exist when he could start creating his music. Mm-hmm. And he does not go for the superficial. He does not go to tie a few notes together. He does not go for anything. And we'll touch about that in a few seconds. He doesn't go for the music schools of the time. No, he's always with a certain distance of the styles that exist at the moment, and he will know them, and he will reflect himself from those things on by taking distance and creating his own world. And creating his own world is going within the music. That means within the notes. That's where he will be trying to create his music, which have to do with what? We have to do with light. We have to do with colors. Trying to see what that light is that go against that darkness that is part of him also. Very difficult to explain. I think I've done my best by trying to get close to it.
Well, the thing about light, now you're reminding me of Sarajevo, which we talked about her, and she's a contemporary. I don't know if they even met. They must have been to the same concerts and stuff, but her music is very, very different in the sense that her music is more like if you're looking at a stream rolling over some rocks and you're looking at the light and how it shifts around, mm-hmm. like this in on the spot right there. And Vivier's music, it's more like light when the sun is rising or setting, which is a long...
Which is the morning light, of course.
Yeah.
Which is that blank and morning light.
So his sound is more like this.
And it's the sound, like the sun coming up, it's the light that goes just over the earth. His music touches the ground floor. This music goes towards something, but there is a mistake one should not make when one listens to his music, is to hear in it the expression of emotions, of humors that one can describe or name. That's the difficulty you and I have here by trying to explain his music. So, this is another grammar. This is another language. You see, in English, I would call it sorrow. Sorrow is without images. It is the beat inside a body confounded with life. And with him, his music is about that life. And it's about the ground floor that is trying to go forward and trying to understand where the horizon is. And his music will resemble him. It's a running away between the notes. It's a running away of the horizon that is in front of you. Thanks to his music, suddenly the horizon just disappears, goes forward. And so it's an extraordinary feeling that you have to learn to listen to.
Yes.
That you have to learn to listen to. But in the work we are going to discuss, Lonely Child, It is most probably the clearest of all, of all. It is the most, it's the one that carries most of that light. Again, we were talking about light. It is, and you would describe very well that it is that morning light. It's the bleak light. It's a kind of bleak light that comes over the world. It's the light that does not come from heaven, or a light that comes from the objects, like in paintings by El Greco. It is light that will come from a human quest, a human quest that comes from a person that he's trying to revive. Lonely Child is about loneliness. It's most probably, yes, about that child that he was. But it has nothing to do with his biography. It is the creation of a persona, which is a kind of universal persona. It is you and I. It is, and that's why there is no frontier anymore. There is no end anymore.
You're making me think of prisms right now. Prism as in light. I'm thinking of many things and that's what Vivier does. That's why preparing for this was so difficult, because there's so many angles to his music. But one angle is the prism, and a prism, you put light through it, and then whoop, the light becomes spread out mm-hmm. into its elements. Am mm-hmm. I right?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
And this is where his spectral music aspect we might be able to talk about it right now. Mm-hmm. Now, spectral music, if I explain it in a sort of a very quick way, and it's hard a little bit to understand, but as a string player, it's easier. But if you play a note on the piano, it's going to start dying right away, mm-hmm. right? Even if you put the pedal, boom, you hear the note that you press, like middle C. And then if you listen to the note dying, mm-hmm. you're going to start hearing other notes. Mm-hmm. Or if you hit the gong, mm-hmm. 50 million, at least a dozen tones you can hear. So spectral music is untangling the sounds of one note.
It's the inside of the sound.
Yes. So the music of Vivier and contemporaries, and this music was sort of a reaction to the very automatic electronic serial music that was going on.
Or mathematical.
Very much. And he doesn't do it electronically. He's going to do it manually with a calculator. But mm-hmm. the thing is, he decomposes the sound. So instead of using sounds to create something, he dives into the sound. And that's where
absolutely
the music happens.
And what he does, in fact, the traditional permutation of notes is replaced by the scrutiny of the inner life of the sounds. And this comes from, as you said very well, the spectral music, you know, which he had learned in France. There is a big French side to him,
yeah.
notwithstanding the incredible influence, especially, let's say, philosophically and poetically, from the German sides, of the German 19th side. So you have those two elements that come together in an absolutely incredible personal way with him, you know, and that makes his music so unique also.
Because also what he loved to do was to play, and this is where we are served, or he is served, by the fact that he wasn't a very good pianist. If he had been a good pianist, an excellent pianist, his music might have been different. But he likes to use two notes.
Sure.
Play two notes at the same time, and then listen.
And then he starts working, bringing in harmonics, taking harmonics out. Okay. And so what he does, he takes, and we call it the melodic notes and the bass note. Yeah. These are his two notes. And that's what he does in the work. We will
Lonely
say
Child.
A few words about that.
And a friend of his asked him, so what are you doing? And he plays two notes at the piano, and he says, listen to this. There's so much in two notes.
This is a world of colors. This is my world. And the world of colors, and I want to come, you know, this is a wonderful way of getting into it. The world of colors is also what he will call love.
Yes.
And so this is another dimension I wanted to put with it.
Please.
But it is... And that world of love and the world of colors takes him away of the darkness.
Yeah.
Of death and the darkness in which he will find himself and the darkness of his sorrow. You know, dolore, douleur in French, these words, you know, it's another language. It's another grammar. It's without images. It's a beat inside the body, confounded with life. And this is music that has to do with life. And it takes everybody. It moves everybody. We don't understand it perhaps at a given moment, but it moves and it is there and it's very sensuous at given moments.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But it's intransitive at the same time. It's intransitive. Wonderful, wonderful, you know. It's like Robert Schumann. You know, when I was quoting these things, I was thinking of Robert Schumann. You know, when one interprets Schumann, he hurts almost physically.
Yeah.
He hurts. He isolates. He exiles. This music is the one of an exile, the one of an isolated one. But what he creates and what he will create in this work also is, of course, it is about solitude. It has nothing to do with the family album. It has nothing to do with biography. It is about creating the figure and the real figure of a solitary child.
Which we are all.
Which we are all. And some so much like him.
Yeah.
And which he continues to resonate within the depths of death. And which his life will show that the poor man will be murdered. He will be attacked 2 times in January of the same year, and then in March, finally, somebody will be able to murder him. And I say will be able to murder him because he rang always so close. He tried to understand what death was about, so he could get rid of it. And after that first attack in Paris at the end of January, he writes an extraordinary letter to Thérèse Desjardins, who was his kind of maternal figure and helped him and is a wonderful lady. I mean, who has been able to keep up going forward and pushing the works by, after his death, the works by Claude Vivier. And in that letter, he said, this time, I have seen it. I've seen it when, you know, somebody tries to kill him with a pair of scissors. And between the end of January and the day he gets murdered by somebody else on the 7th of March, he writes a text which will be the basis of his last unfinished work. He had difficulties to finish it because he knew he was getting close in one way or another. His intuition was about dying. He writes an incredible text that will be the basis of the last work. And the last work is Glaubst du an die Unsterblichkeit des Seeles? Do you believe in the immortality of the soul? It's very interesting that he'd never finished that work. So there is no immortality. Strange. That's a strange remark I just made, rather for myself than anything else.
So it's like every piece of music that he wrote was reaching out from his despair for a little bit of peace. And when, I mean, it doesn't make you feel more despair when you listen to him. You feel comforted always.
You feel comforted.
A lot of his music is like that.
Absolutely.
If you want, we can start in on Lonely Child, but because it brings me to this, the text. Beautiful child of light, sleep, 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 always sleep. The dreams will come and the fairies will come dance with you. That's Lonely Child. And then it goes on. So his title was Lonely Child. It was in English. And the mystery, he thought, it's just the right title. It was, he couldn't find the right title in French. So there it is. There's French in there and there's invented language, which are, it's fascinating, and sounds made by the singer. Now, what I noticed also in his music is that he had muses, and and they were women, right? Women voice inspirations. And I can't help but think that, you know, you say it's death. Death is always around him, yes. There's death. I feel maybe, but we can speculate.
Of course, of course.
I feel what I recognize in him that's in me is this search for God, always the search for something. So, and then there's this, you told me, and I read also that he preferred to sleep with the lights on. And I feel like if you're a grown up and you prefer to sleep with the lights on, that's big. That's big.
Yeah, it has to do with anguish. It has to do with anguish.
Yeah, yes.
So the wonderful things have been said about that. I think also in Nietzsche somewhere.
Tell me.
The stars continue making you understand that they give you the light, they continue giving light, and that light of the daily life is brought forward with anguish. So,
yeah.
And anyhow, when you're in front of the stars, most of the time, you feel solitary.
You feel small.
You feel small, you feel alone, and you ask yourself the question that you were asking, that is there anything that explains this extraordinary billions of other possibilities of what we are? By putting the light on, you don't see the stars. I just came back from South Africa. I could see the stars because the city is, you know, in the desert. There is no light. And you have a wonderful, extraordinary view of the starry, starry night. Ah, Vincent van Gogh, yes. So we have, the stars bring forward reflection and bring forward reflection of what solitude is about. And solitude is most probably the source of anguish, the ultimate source of anguish. So we wanted to cut them out. That's why he put on the lights.
Right.
Putting on the lights, you know, it's okay.
So this lonely child that we're going to play, you can hear this spectral music. You can hear these very interesting sounds.
What we just explained, yes.
And the voice, the woman's voice saying, sleep, sleep, dreams will come, fairies will come dance with you. That's all beautiful and peaceful.
Try to sleep.
And then it's interrupted by drums. And my question to you, and I now it's trotting in my head, and I must know the answer. If you're going to tell somebody what you need to bring out in this music, what is it?
Yeah, but what is it? Well, it is his music. What does he want to bring out?
Yes.
He wants to tell it through his music. And so how does he do that? I think what is the almost as important as the texts that are brought in, the texts take over, of course, and people listen to the text. Mm-hmm. But one has to listen to the music also. And he starts with this very short introduction. 23 measures, 1 to 23, nothing. It's a minute and 50 seconds or something like that. Yeah.
And he
starts, yeah. Two instruments, percussion instruments. And it's to mark what is time. What is time? His life has been a battle with time. Mm-hmm. We have been talking about death, we have talked about youth, we have talked about how long shall I live, but it is time, ultimately. Die Zeit, Kind, Kind. Other romantics, Die Zeit, Kind, Kind. This is the opera by Richard Strauss. The reflection of the Marschallin is about time and time that flees. So what he marks time and the beginning of time, and the instruments of percussion do that. But they open up right away in those wonderful harmonics, thanks to the rin. The rin, which is a Japanese instrument, something between a bell and a gong.
Perfect. That's a perfect
and
the
perfect
instrument.
for the harmonics to flow into the universe and open up, and flowing is fleeing. Don't forget that. Flowing is fleeing also. So there is at the same time between those notes a continuous running away of the music. The running away of music, which is searching, is the music is search, and searching is the music. And we go to those two instruments, and it's a profound sound, and then he goes to the bass drums. Even more profound, which resonate on 13 black notes. It's very long, warm. And then you enter into the work. And the soprano sings what you just said, what you just read perfectly. Sleep, my child. Sleep, my child. So forget about this world, but it's not necessarily. So we have been talking about sleeping, we have been talking about dreaming, we have been talking about fairy tales, there's what it goes. But this world is not a fairy tale. And we all know this. The world is not a fairy tale. And then comes that melody and that first movement. And then you're in the first sequence. Now, I must say there are a total of four sequences. And let me give you the structure, because there's a structure in this work, an yes. extraordinary structure. Yes, so there is the intro, and then you have a first sequence in which the soprano sings the fairy-like text in French. And so the English title, and there you have the fairy tale in French. Ah, what does this all mean? We could talk centuries about all that. Yes. And you get the fairy tale in French. And then comes the second sequence in which she will sing in invented language. Now, the invented language, and there are elements of the rin coming back in it, and of the bass drums also, within that part. So he brings in the bass drums at the point with the invented music again. And he will mention the name Tadzio three times yes. in it. And now Tadzio, for those that know literature, it's Death in Venice. And Tadzio is this beautiful boy, androgynous boy. And it is so beautiful and so complex that, in which the composer or the writer... dreams the love sequence. He falls in love with this androgynous boy, And now the androgynous world is a world that really opened up the road towards the female is there very much. And you were talking about those that inspired him, the voice, it is the female voice that inspired him. And then there's a wonderful book written by Jean-Jacques Nattier, great musicologist, on Wagner and androgynia and the androgynous elements in the Ring cycle and in his operas. And believe me, that's why there is some Wagner-like sounds in those, in that part. Isn't that extraordinary? Isn't that extraordinary? But I want you to, tell the people that are listening, it is such rich music, and it tells the story of 200 years, 300 years of music, eternity into music, and it goes towards the future, creating that figure. You see, the figure of that lonely child is like the figure of Don Giovanni. Don Giovanni is a kind of abstract element that is being described by some of the greatest writers and some of the greatest musicians. And it is not a one person, but at the same time, he only can start from himself. He doesn't describe life in general. He describes a life. In his music, it's very realistic. Also, it's over the earth. When you started explaining the light, it just goes over the earth. The music of Vivier runs over the earth, and takes all the richness of the earth with it.
Yeah, and it dissolves.
Absolutely. And so we are in that second sequence in which the invented language comes. And then comes a third sequence, and it's back into French. And then wonderful little interlude. And the interlude is a kind of reflection of the intro. And you get the same instruments coming back. You know, the 10 big moments of the bass drum. Bam!
Jean-Jacques,
cutting into the piece.
I wish that wasn't there.
Oh, I know.
You like it.
We talked about that. It cuts into the piece. It bites into it, you know. But also with two moments of the Rin. And then you get into sequence 4, where both French and the invented language come forward, and in word, in which you could perhaps read those very last lines in which Tadzio comes back, the figure of Tadzio, of death in Venice, and that is...
outside of time appears my child. The stars in heaven shine for you, Tadzio, and love you eternally.
And the son of the tam-tam and of the Rin, the work ends in a coda. So, the stars... Tadzio, and we have prepared all this in our big first part of our presentation today. You have the stars, you have Tadzio, also the stars, eternity over our head. This young man who is on his way to womanhood, perhaps, you know. And the opening of that too, of our sexuality, and also about time and eternity.
I find it quite strange. Now you met Claude Vivier.
Timelessness. Yes, I did meet him. Yes, and we had long discussions.
And you're talking about time, and you know, if I rely on the description that I have of him, he was exuberant. He was sometimes out of place. He was so, and he had this.
He was impossible sometimes.
Impossible.
Yeah. Not with me, but I mean, you know, he had to fight it out. So I mean, just.
And he had this laugh, apparently people talk about it, where he had this laugh that was, not derisoire, what's the word I'm looking for? He had a laugh that was very, that was punctuated things, interrupted things, and was rarely happy.
It was a loud one in which there were empty moments. I was saying the same. Yeah.
So talk about time and controlling time, like you were saying, which is the most important element almost. And I can't imagine this man all over the place, almost annoying, sitting down and producing something
He was a hard worker. He was a hard worker.
Isn't that
he
became amazing?
He went to sit down. He was very, very, very hard worker. But that was when he was by himself. Then he was out of the public fields. I mean, we could talk a long time about that. If you don't mind, I would like to talk about timelessness, because you mentioned it's in that last part of the word timelessness. He was searching that, and at a given moment he describes it, and it's the going from one bank to the other bank. It's crossing the river Styx, you know, the river that takes you to the other side, to the death. And the crossing of that, he called that timelessness.
Mm.
And I mean, in one of his texts, and I do think this is, and it's again, I'm coming back to Robert Schumann. When Robert Schumann went on that bridge before he wanted to suicide, when he threw himself over the bridge into the Rhine, he gave something to the guy who was looking after the bridge. He paid his dues, like the obol, the money that you have to give to the man who takes you over the Styx. And there's long reflections by him on that also. So he and the fact that his life ended so violently into death, it was somewhere in his mind in the last two, certainly in the two last months, it was as if he was ready. And one cannot say it had nothing to do with suicide. This man was not suicidal. He was a happy, jolly fellow. He was the heart of the party. You know, you mentioned about those things, you know. But there was that other him that was so much more important, and which for me was more important to try to give some light to lonely child.
That's a perfect place to pause. So we're going to play Lonely Child here in Ottawa, and then we'll take it on tour. I'm so happy that we're representing him on our tour in Europe, spring 2019. I have one quote, maybe you'll like it, by something, because he wrote a lot about music.
Oh, he wrote a lot about music. And it's incredible. I mean,
he wrote, "Sound is the point of no contact between melancholy and hope."
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like, yeah, it's something inside me. That's where he touches me.
Mm-hmm.
Where if you listen to his music, you don't go either way. You're sort of in the middle of hope and you're okay.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a reassurance, his music, I find.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's reassurance, and he succeeded.
Yes.
What he describes, what art was about. Art is not what serves life again, you know. It's not a reflection, and it's not a double of life. It's not recycling life. But it is something that pushes life forward with other means. What a wonderful description of art.
Yeah.
Pushes life forward with other means. He pushes it forward in the most extreme way. And that's what his short life was about.
And we can say to finish that he left us too soon. He didn't hear a lot of his music, he didn't hear played, including Lonely Child. And we will be honoring him this way.
17 minutes of one of the greatest, if not the greatest, Canadian piece of music.
Jean-Jacques, thank you.
This has been a National Arts Center podcast produced in Ottawa by NAC New Media. Send us your comments and questions. Email us at nacpodcasts@gmail.com. Visit the podcast section of the iTunes store where you can rate and comment on this podcast. We love to hear from you. Remember, you can find more great NAC podcasts at nacpodcast.ca. Or search on National Arts Center on iTunes and subscribe for free. Until next time, goodbye from Canada's National Arts Center.